Quick, if today is a Sunday, what day will it be 45 plus 38 days from now? If you said Saturday, you are correct. This can be done quickly by realizing that 45 is 3 more than 42, a multiple of 7, and 38 is 3 more than 35, another multiple of 7, all together giving us 3 plus 3, 6. We need to go 6 days forward in the week from Sunday to Saturday. But let's be more formal now in how we write this. We'll also do a multiplication example, and we'll also try to explain why this works in general with a proof. The directions say compute 45 plus 38 mod 7 by modding first. What in the world does that mean? This is modular arithmetic, also called clock arithmetic, and it means exactly what I said before. 45 equals 6 times 7, which is 42, plus 3. In other words, when you divide 45 by 7, you get a quotient of 6 and a remainder of 3. 3 is the remainder, and because of that, that means 45 mod 7 equals 3. This expression represents the remainder you get when you divide this number by this number. It's 3. A similar kind of thing happens with the 38. 38 is 5 times 7 plus 3. 3 is the remainder in that case, and that implies that 38 mod 7 also equals 3. So when you mod first, you are really converting these 45 and 38s to 3s. More formally, we can write that 45 plus 38 mod 7 will end up giving the same thing, though this takes proof, as 3 plus 3 mod 7. But 3 plus 3 is 6. What is 6 mod 7? When I divide 6 by 7, I get a quotient of 0 and a remainder of 6. This equals 6. What if we had done the regular addition first? 45 plus 38 equals 83. What is 83 mod 7? When I divide 83 by 7, I get a quotient of 11. 11 times 7 is 77, and a remainder of 6. The remainder that I get is 6, therefore this equals 6, and that is the exact same answer that I got before. Does this work with multiplication? Evidently it does. Let's do 45 times 38 mod 7. 45 times 38 mod 7. I can mod first. Once again, 45 mod 7 is 3. 38 mod 7 is 3. 3 times 3 is 9. So I ultimately have to compute 9 mod 7. What is the remainder that I get when I divide 9 by 7? The quotient is 1 and the remainder is 2. The answer here is 2. Does this work the other way? Well, let's use our calculator to help us here. What is 45 times 38? It's 1,710. Evidently, when I divide 1,710 by 7, I should get a remainder of 2. Let's divide this by 7. I get a decimal. If I subtract off the whole number part and multiply what's left by 7, I get 2. That implies the remainder is 2. 1,710 equals 244 times 7 plus 2. If you're not sure, you can double check it. 244 times 7 plus 2 is 1,710. This implies that the answer is 2. I get the exact same thing as before. But now, why does this work? Let's do it for the more mysterious one, the multiplication, and I'll leave the proof for the less mysterious one, the addition, to you. Let's suppose we've got two numbers, call them A and B, and I'm going to add these mod some number n. So for our problem, A was 45, B was 38, and n was 7. Since these are arbitrary numbers, I don't know exactly what they equal. Let's just say this one equals some number, call it A prime, and this one equals some other number, call it B prime. These are the remainders that I get when I divide these numbers by n. By definition, it is important to note that remainders must be between 0 and n, possibly including 0, but not including n. That's true in both cases. What does this mean? This means there are some quotients, say call them Q sub A and Q sub B, such that A equals Q sub A times N plus A prime, and B equals Q q sub b times n plus b prime. This is an abstract form of the particular kinds of examples that I wrote before. Now compute a times b. Go ahead and use these expressions. I'm not modding yet, I'm just doing an irregular multiplication. If you're going to go ahead and multiply these things, you will need to use the so-called FOIL method. First times first, outside times outside, inside times inside, and last times last. The product of first times first is the product of these two things. That would be q sub a times q sub b times n times n, in other words, times n squared. Outside times outside will be q sub a times n times b prime. Q sub a times n times b prime. Inside times inside will be a prime times q sub b times n. I'll write that as q sub b times n times a prime. And last times last will be a prime times b prime. What am I ultimately trying to show? I haven't asked that yet. That would be worth asking. My goal is to show that when I do a times b mod n, I get the same thing as what I get when I compute a prime times b prime mod n. Back in this example, both a prime and b prime were 3. Coming back down here, I'm trying to show that the remainder is the same in both cases when I divide both of these numbers by n. Can this expression help me do that? Yes, though it is tricky. What we want to do is we want to take this expression and all the parts that involve n, we want to factor an n out. We can write that this expression ultimately equals qa times qb, I won't bother writing the dot anymore, times one factor of n. From this thing, I'm factoring out one factor of n, leaving me with a n to the first power. Then I take this thing and I take away the n because there's already an n to the first power, so I get qa times b prime. Then this one has a plus qb times a prime, and n has been factored out. Outside the parentheses, I need the n. And then don't forget the a prime times b prime. This seems like it might be enough. I've got a times b equals something, a quotient, times n plus, what is this, a remainder? Well, it would be the remainder if a prime times b prime happens to be less than n. However, in this example, it wasn't. A prime times b prime was 9. 9 is not less than 7. So we have to be a little bit more careful. How can we be more careful? We need to realize that, again, this thing could be bigger than n, but I could still divide this by n and get a remainder. I could write a prime times b prime equals some other quotient, call it, I don't know, how about q times n plus some remainder, I don't know what it is, just call it r for remainder. This remainder would be guaranteed to be between 0 and n by definition. It could be 0, but not n. And now I can just go ahead and substitute over here. I can group this part together with the other part. I can write qa qb n plus qa b prime plus qb a prime plus q times n and then plus r. And r is guaranteed to be in this range. It will be the remainder, both in dividing a prime times b prime by n, and also because of the equality of this with this, in dividing a times b by n. And that's the proof. We're done. Q E D. Thanks for watching.